no, is he really going to review the game show games on the NES? Unsubscribe. GameTech was known for publishing game show games on the NES. These included the obvious Jeopardy and Wheel of Fortune games that made up 8 different games on the system, but also things like Harlem Globetrotters and American Gladiators. And if you stayed home sick during the late 80s and early 90s, GameTech got all the daytime game show reruns like Hollywood Squares, Classic Concentration, Double Dare, and Family Feud. These are the ones we'll be focusing on today, and while game show games are forgotten and overlooked for really good reason, they probably helped motivate more than a few parents to buy the NES for their kids, or heck, even for themselves. Hollywood Squares was a long-running game show dating back to 1966. The premise of the game is all about improv and deception. Actual celebrities fill a 3x3 vertical grid and act as tic-tac-toe squares. The host, John Davidson in the late 80s, has a contestant choose a square. Davidson then asks the celebrity in the square the question, and that celebrity will give either an answer or a bluff. The contestant then either agrees or disagrees with the celebrity. If they choose right, they get their mark, an X or an O, in the square, just like tic-tac-toe. The show featured lots of great celebrities who doled out the zingers. Many celebrities were mainstays growing up. I thought it was all Joan Rivers was famous for, was being on Hollywood Squares. The first thing you'll notice about the game, though, there are no celebrities. There's a Pam, I know a Pam, a Daz, a Mary, a May. Who are these people? Dean, I know a few Deans, but these aren't celebrities, which is kind of a bummer. Without Hollywood, this game is just squares. There could have been an opportunity here to at least get cute with it, and use historical figures like Ben Franklin or Gandhi if they couldn't secure the likenesses of actual, alive, celebrities. Oh well. The game starts out with the host John Davidson kinda looking like John Davidson, and you picking your character. Elon Musk will have to do. The questions aren't too hard or too simple, but they are trapped in time, as is the problem with these old trivia games. I don't know random pop culture nuggets from 1989, but thankfully I just have to agree or disagree and not type in an answer. You'll notice the celebrities give a zinger before answering the question. Some are kind of cheesy, but others weren't too bad or were just so ridiculous they made me giggle, like this one. What was Karl Marx talking about when he called it the opium of the masses? And the zinger response was Geraldo Rivera. Then they provide their real answer, which you must interpret as either the truth or a bluff. Choose correctly, win a square. You play 3 rounds, and if you win the whole thing, either by winning 2 of 3 matches or getting more squares in total in case of ties, you pick a key and the chance to win a car. This part is all luck. You pick a key, then you scroll through the series of cars, pick one, actually guessed right once, which would have been pretty awesome if it weren't all made up. In general, the game respects the source material quite well. The trivia questions aren't overly obscure, but there are no difficulty options, and the zingers can actually be humorous. All in all, not spectacular, but not awful. Okay, what's next?
Behind these numbers is a puzzle. Can you solve it? Bar plus bra, Barbara. Walt plus tears, Walter. Barbara Walters. If you can do that, you have a chance to win one of these 8 fabulous cards as we play Classic Concentration. And here's the host of Concentration, Alex Trebek.
Wow. Including Jeopardy games, Alex Trebek is featured in as many NES games as Arnold Schwarzenegger. And that's a whole separate video idea. Anyway, this is one I didn't really watch growing up, but I always enjoyed puzzles like this in school. Essentially, two contestants go back and forth trying to match items in a random memory game. When they guess two like items correctly, those blocks disappear, slowly unveiling a puzzle beneath, puzzleception, if you will. If you flip a wild card, it will take away the next block you choose and its corresponding block, clearing out even more of the puzzle. If you flip two wild cards, like the CPU opponent did, then the effect is completely lost. Way to go, Lynn. One annoying thing is the game has to show the contestant celebrating after each correct guess. Yeah, we get it. The puzzle beneath is actually called a rebus puzzle. Thanks, Wikipedia. These puzzles combine symbols, letters, and pictures to form the sounds of words. In general, these puzzles are a fun challenge, and there is no time limit here, which means you can take as long as you want to sound it all out. And some are pretty tough, mainly because the answers are probably relevant to 1988, and I'm kinda stupid. I got this one right, though. It was Lionel Hampton, and I have no idea who that is, but I got it right, so. You can solve the puzzle as early as you want, too, even if not all the blocks are removed from the board yet. In fact, look what the computer did to me. Yeah, right, Lynn. How did you see this? Out of this? Are you kidding me? Also, what is that? What is it? Turns out it's a con and not a tumor wearing a hat. Character selection here is the same as it was in Hollywood Squares. I'll go with Eric Estrada. One thing odd about the game is there is no penalty for an incorrect guess, as there would be in something like Wheel of Fortune. If you flip two blocks and wager a guess and it's wrong, it's okay. You get to flip blocks again until you don't flip two matching ones. But it's like that in the actual game show, too. Another thing about the game is the start screen forces you to watch the back of this guy while he plays piano. The game doesn't let you start until it's darn good and ready. Other than that, this game is true to the game show, even if the prizes are lame and it's a little slow.
Take a risk. Take a chance. Take a dare. Play the game of Double Dare. With the host of Double Dare, Alex Trebek.
No. You have got to be kidding me.
Thank you, Johnny.
Oh, wrong channel. There we go. That's the Double Dare this game's based on.
Here comes your favorite splats. Flops.
Yeah. That's right. Alex Trebek hosted the first run of Double Dare that aired on CBS from 1976 through 77. It was revived in 1986 on Nickelodeon, hosted by Mark Summers, though it's not clear if Mark Summers is the host in the game. The show was known for being gross. And because kids are gross and like being gross, the show did well. It works like this. One team is asked a question, and if they answer it, they win money. If they guess wrong, the other team wins money. Or if they don't know it, they can dare the other team to answer it, which ups the ante. If that team can answer it, they win the money. They can also get it wrong, and the money goes to the first team, or they can double dare. You still with me? Now the answer is worth even more money. If the first team still can't answer it, they can opt for a physical challenge. If you complete the challenge successfully, then you get a boatload of money for the question, which no one got right. It pays to be brave and not smart, according to Double Dare. But if you miss it, no one gets money, and everyone moves on with their lives except one team is a little bit more gross. The physical challenges include cake catch, where you jump on a trampoline to catch a cake, water basketball, where you shoot a water balloon through a hoop, putty golf, which is self-explanatory, pie in your pants, where you catch a pie in your pants, and kangaroo catch, where you catch a kangaroo in what also looks to be your pants. There are some others, but no matter what the challenge is, all you need to know is that they are timed at about 20 or 30 seconds and are all unnecessarily hard. The meter at the bottom is ridiculous. It looks simple, and the NES controller only has about 4 buttons on it, but I still needed a manual. For speed, you hold left on the controller and let off when you want it to stop, and then the angle meter starts. Here, you press right on the D-pad, and then A or B when you want it to stop. And even if you stop it exactly how you mean to, nothing will work as intended. The pants games are by far the easiest because they don't use that meter. But somehow, those games are not even as annoying as the head-to-head contests. You have to win those to go first in the game. Going first has its perks, as the questions are answered on a make-it-take-it basis. That is, if you answer right, you get asked another question, so you can railroad the other team if you're on a roll. To decide who goes first, you're pitted head-to-head, and this is probably better against the human opponent, but you stand almost no chance against the computer. You have to fight the meter and the AI. It stinks. Just get used to going second. And all that is not even as bad as the end of the game. If you do outsmart your opponents and win, you have to win an obstacle course for the grand prize, and it is bad. First, it's like 10 miles long, and you have 1 minute to do it in. And, in typical NES fashion, whenever sprinting is involved, you have to mash buttons nonsensically to make anything happen. Good luck getting that pixel-perfect placement on this jump to grab this flag, and how do I get up this thing? Do I just tap up, or both left? I don't even know. I've never won the grand prize. So anyway, like the others, there's a character selection screen, and I of course went with Cindy Brady. You can also choose the game's difficulty here, which is nice, but it only affects the questions. The challenges and the obstacle courses are still maddening to master. Despite being the most ambitious game of the bunch, with all the mini-games that come with it, Double Dare is by far the worst, as all of that stuff falls super duper flat. The actual trivia questions are fine, I guess. Alright, one more to go.
Let's meet the Warner family. Scott, Rebecca, Carol, Denise, and Kevin, ready for action. Playing against the Valvis family. Georgia, Sharon, Dave, Tina, and Joyce, on your mark. Let's start the Family Feud. With the star of Family Feud, Ray Cohn.
Family Feud has been airing since 1976 and is currently hosted by comedian Steve Harvey. The era the game is based on was hosted by Ray Combs, though his likeness is not used in the game. If you're not familiar with how Family Feud works, I'll make it quick. There are two families consisting of five contestants each who square off against each other. Questions are originally asked to 100 ordinary people, and those answers are ranked by popularity. The contestants guess the most popular answers. There are usually anywhere between 3 and 10 available answers for each question. Here's an example. Name an occasion when relatives come to visit. Here you see some correct answers were Christmas and Thanksgiving. Money, or points essentially, are awarded based on how many of those original 100 chose it. At the beginning, the teams compete in a buzzer round. If a team answers correctly, they can take control of the board and guess as many on the list as possible, but there is a strategy to it. If they don't guess them all, the other team will get a chance to guess, and they could win all the money if they succeed, so you either go first and guess them all right, or go second and undercut the other team. It's an interesting concept. The video game is true to these rules, with the only thing really holding it back is how picky the computer is with your answers. For example, I was listing things vampires don't like. I tried sun, light, and sunlight before failing, and the computer would have accepted daylight. Similarly, in an odd question about what body parts women stress over most, I said chest, and they would have accepted breasts. Tomato, potato. One bummer is that you can't choose your family, which I guess makes it more realistic. The game is actually a little difficult to win against the computer unless you can name 9 birds that can't fly. I can only name 4. And because the game is tough, in order to see the final stage, I had to play it for an hour and quickly discovered that the game only has 1 musical track. So there's that. If you lose to the other family, the game makes up some excuse as to why that family could not compete in the final round, presumably because they didn't program an animation of them actually participating in it. But if you win, the final round consists of a similar format, but you provide a single answer for 5 different questions. Your points are combined, and you can carry them over to the next match. The game says you don't get to keep your money until you score 20,000, which would take winning several games, so yeah, good luck with that. The game would actually work for 10 players, 5 on each team. I could actually see that being a little fun and wonder if it ever happened. Alright, we did it. We talked about game show games. Ultimately, I don't expect to have motivated anyone to play these games, but it's interesting how true to the game show's game tech was with these adaptations. The limitations are largely the aged questions, and for Double Dare, it's the whole thing. If you take away the game show aspect, Hollywood Squares, Classic Concentration, and Family Feud are actually fun trivia and puzzle games, and aren't as bad as the game show stigma would suggest. Alright everybody, thanks for watching.